Ma'am, we have started live telecast on Facebook now.
Okay.
Our speaker has joined us, Professor Shankar Ghosh. So, Professor, I welcome Professor Arun Grover, sir, Vice President SPSTI, to give the opening remarks. Professor Arun Grover, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, please. Yes, we can.
So, it's my pleasure to welcome our speaker, Professor Shankar Ghosh, our guest of honor today, Professor S.K. Dhar, and all the online audience on the occasion of a launch of a new series of lectures on the platform Online Science Playground. On behalf of the Society for Promotion of Science and Technology in India and the Chandigarh chapter of National Academy of Sciences in India. The society, SPSTI, had been conceived in the birth centenary year of Homi Bhabha in 2009. To launch the commemoration of birth centenary of Homi Bhabha, the Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh, had stated, and I quote, Dr. Homi Bhabha spent his whole life in the pursuit of a grand vision. He inspired a generation of scientists with his bold dreams and ambitions for the nation and his selfless service. He was a bold scientific pioneer and builder of modern India. He went on, Dr. Manmohan Singh went on to add that we should show the same wisdom and pragmatism and foresight that Dr. Homi Bhabha did. He said, I have no doubt that we will move purposefully and substantially to realize his grand vision. The president of SPSTI envisioned SPSTI in 2009 to be an NGO that would intervene and inculcate scientific temperament in the students, teachers, and the community at large through its standing activities, including organization of summer schools in science and mathematics, mobile science laboratory, circus of science, public and popularization science lectures, okay, evening lectures, community awareness sessions, panel discussion, quiz competitions, and many more. The Science Playground in California, Science Playground in California Science Center is a dynamic resource for children and families, students and educators, and the people of all ages to explore wonders of science. The physical science playground in California Science Center stands closed today due to pandemic at the moment. It would take us a long time before we can create an equivalent of California Science Center in Chandigarh. However, we thought of creating it virtually by reaching out to the talented young scientists of India and enticing them to share their way of doing research from their own laboratory space in association with their own students and share it with the general audience comprising undergraduate and postgraduate students from colleges and university departments while they are logged in from their respective homes. Homi Bhabha had envisioned his first institute, namely the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research at Bombay, to be a physical space where proper conditions for work and the intelligent financial support would enable the very best students sourced out from the universities of India to grow as researchers at the frontiers of science, comparable to those graduating out from the best centers in the world. The year 2020, incidentally, is the 75th year since the foundation of TIFR in 1945. So our new initiative for me personally as if commemorating the 75th year of TIFR. I have no hesitation in stating that the 21st century India that in the 21st century India, the proper conditions of doing science and the intelligent financial support stands provided in large number of institutes all across India, be they be IITs of India, ISERS of India, Indian Institute of Science, Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, national labs like CCMB, NCBS, NII, NCRA, IUCs of UGC system, or AIIMS and PGI-like institutes all across India, central universities, good central universities of India, etc. So intelligent financial support in the form of Inspire Fellowships, Ramanujam Fellowship, Ramalinga Swami Fellowship, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Fellowship, KVPY Fellowship, CSR, DST, and ICMR, ICAR Fellowship, etc., stand assured by Government of India today. However, a lot more is necessary for the large number of young talented students emerging out of the universities of India at the present times. To sustain the motivation of young people to pursue science, the online science platform is a small step in the larger agenda that the nation wishes to pursue. We trust that the new experiment being launched today would be found worthwhile by our audience. So with this, I conclude my address. Thank you very much.
We now request Professor Dhar to introduce today's speaker. Professor Dhar.
Hello, am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Very good afternoon to all of you. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Shankar Ghosh to all of you, who is giving the first lecture in this new series launched by SPSTI, which is entitled The Science Playground. Shankar and I have been colleagues for 14 long years in the Condensed Department of Condensed Matter Physics and at TAFR, and I have listened to his many talks, seminars, colloquia, and tea table conversations, and he always gave me the impression of one trying to explore new grounds rather than treading the known and mundane. This tendency of Shankar to pursue new scientific problems was evident very early in his research career. For example, in his PhD work, one of the very important observations which he made, he did his PhD at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, was that he reported the generation of measurable voltages and currents when a gas flows over a variety of solids, or a liquid flows over single-walled nanotube bundles. He was awarded the INSA Medal for Young Scientist in 2006. Over the years, Shankar has matured into an accomplished physicist who has contributed substantially to our understanding of several issues in the area of soft condensed matter physics, such as gas desorption, peeling, delamination, which are friction and adhesion driven dissipative phenomena, and which occur over spatial and temporal time scales that vary over orders of magnitude. Furthermore, illuminating the rich physics of how elastic interfaces traverse random media, Shankar has selected unconventional but real problems of everyday life. His research on friction-dominated particulate systems, such as colloidal films, particle wraps, cement, and submerged hydrophobic granular column, has contributed towards understanding the general problem of density-driven phase transitions in particulate systems. Shankar's work on the interplay between dissipation and self-organization is singularly important in understanding the emergence of order in complex systems. He has constantly innovated and developed high-precision experimental techniques, some of which I have seen myself in TIFR. Actually, our labs were adjacent to each other. We were sharing a common wall. For his important contributions over the years, Professor Shankar Ghosh was awarded the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in Physical Sciences for the year 2019. So over to Shankar for his talk.
So do I start my talk?
Yes.
So thank you, Suresh. Thank you, Professor Grover, for introducing me and giving me the opportunity to speak here. Now, I realize from the communication that I had from Professor K.R. Devarambir, is this the audience is going to be roughly, and the target audience is going to be high school students and undergraduate students. Am I right, Professor Devarambir?
Yes, yes, yes. That was our intention.
That was your intention, right? So I will stick to that intention. So, and I will, and I was also told that, you know, I could and should switch to Hindi occasionally, which would probably make it better in terms of communications. And if I do so, you have to realize that I'm a Bengali and my Hindi can be slightly dicey. Huh? But anyway, if I do, and when I do in the flow, agar kuch galti ho jata hai, toh maaf kar dijiyega. And I'm sure that I'll make a lot of mistakes, especially regarding the gender of in the gender. You know, in Bengali, we don't have genders in that sense, in the language. Okay, anyway, so what do I do? So I grew up in this city called Siliguri, and I had this unconventional trajectory. The reason was that, you know, when your kids are growing up, I see my kids also, she's in class 10 and others that I interact with. People are extremely, today, what would I say, very well defined in their minds and what they want to achieve in life, what they want to do. Unlike when I was growing up, I was totally clueless of what I wanted to do, what was my calling, nothing of that sort. So a lot of these things happened by chance. So my father asked me that, you know, enough of loitering about in Siliguri, why don't you do something else? Go to a different city and get some education from there. So I go to Delhi. So this was in 1997 that I went to Delhi. And from there, I made my transition to Bangalore. And from Bangalore, I've moved to Mumbai, and I've been since there. And I remember a very winter morning in Gwalior when I met Professor Rampi and Professor Grover. And this was in December. And I still remember that was the day when Sehwag scored 190. India lost the test match anyway. So, and they told me that they were interested if I had wanted to apply to TIFR. And you imagine this kid who never thought that he would make a big life, but suddenly thinks that, you know, there's an opportunity for him to apply in TIFR. Anyway, that's how life folded out for me, and I landed up in TIFR. So what motivates me as a researcher? There are many ways that you can think of a researcher. You think, you know, you've heard Professor Grover about funds. You know, it's essential that you get funds and you work in important laboratories which have lots of facilities. But there's another thing also which motivates researchers, and which typically young people have in abundance, and that is imagination. So the way that this problem, the way at least my science progresses, and I will illustrate to you how my science progresses, and I'll basically use this platform as a platform where I will actually share with you my thought process of how I tackle problems. Is basically to find out interesting problems which you think you don't understand, and instead of taking a straight cut answer, oh, this is simple, you go and try to explore it. And so essentially that's the whole thing that's the philosophy of my research. And we typically try to find out extraordinary things in everyday life. And I'll show you how extraordinary things, it's easy to find out extraordinary things in everyday life. And as a kid, you're always amazed by it, except that you're probably your education and everything else, and your willing, or your, what is it, the right word? It's your wish to get into the pass through this entrance examination of various places kind of kills that child in you. Anyway. So let me go through the glimpses of our research. So I'll try and share the screen. If you were here in person, this is roughly the view that you get. You know, it's inspiring. We scientists can't be in isolation. So TIFR is such a wonderful place. The first time I walked into this place, it just blew me off. So I thought that, you know, it might be not be a bad idea to just run through what is the typical routine of ours, that we walk through the gardens of TIFR. That's a seashore for us. And then, and how do we get into the lab? So that's my student, Satyanu, is getting a stroll about in the gardens of TIFR. And and that's the main area of TIFR, and you can have Hussein's paintings. A lot of these paintings are actually about this. It's a wonderful place to be in. And then this comes to the part that basically that's getting to a lab. It's in the basement. You walk down from the ground floor, you go walk down to the basement. And our lab is basically identified as something called a BB30. BB is B block, basement, and 30 is a room number. That's what we are, and that's where we exist. These are the people in the lab presently. There are others who are no more in the lab. They've passed on and now have faculty positions at various places. Harsh, Shoman, Satyanu, Akash, Smita, and Amit. So I will take you a few examples. The first example that I will take you is about shape molding. Now let me just stop the share and, you know, let me stop the share and let me just get to this point. Okay, so what is a shape molding? So let me look at this particular aspect of it. So suppose you have a paper like this. I'll give you a flat sheet of paper and I want to make something like this. Okay, this is a part of an hemisphere. How do I go from this point to this point? Yeah, this is kind of a very geometry kind of a problem, right? You could deal with this problem in your everyday life. That I take something like this and I want to create a shape like that. Now, one way of doing it, if this shape is not very complicated, is, well, you do this. You know, you get your Venpuri of course there. That's a cone. A cone is something in three dimensions. Well, that's a fair enough thing to do. But the cone is a very special structure. But you could want to have structures which are not cone-like. For example, this could be a part of the ball. It could be something else. And how would you go about doing it? And let me show you something, an interesting example. Something that you have done constantly in your chemistry labs, for example. Okay. So what do we have? And I'll request many of you to go back into your labs or, you know, at your home and try it with this experiment. Take a circular piece of your filter paper, take any paper for that, sure. What I've taken is I've taken a beaker. You take it on the top of it and try to push this one into it. You will get a fold like that. Okay. This is an instability which converts a flat sheet to a three-dimensional structure. This instability is called the three-dimensional instability. And what basically we have done to go from a flat sheet to a folded structure, we have basically hidden a part of this filter paper inside. You have tucked it in. This is exactly what you do in umbrellas. Now, umbrellas, when they open up, they're like a canopy, right? And when you pull down the umbrella, all that extra cloth goes inside, right? So you tuck in the cloths. This is something that they do in origami in a regular thing. Now, why would you say that, you know that origami and these kinds of foldings actually give you three-dimensional structure, then why would I be interested in actually explaining something of that sort to you? Now, realize that if you, in the early morning, if you get your newspaper and say you want to fold your newspaper, this is not a newspaper, but let me hold it in my hand and try and show you this experiment. Okay, so what I've done is, okay, I've opened up my newspaper, but unfortunately, I've forgotten how to actually fold it back. Because, you know, I can fold it this way. Well, that was not the right fold. I could fold it this way and that way. Well, that was also not the right fold. And usually you find that your moms are usually shouting at you or dad is shouting at you because you have not folded your newspaper properly, and unfolded newspaper takes more space, right? So newspaper folds are difficult because they are 90 degree in fold. So essentially, if you look at any of these folds in newspaper, you'll find that between these two folds, there is 90 degrees. And so is the ingenuity of human beings that 90 degree folds are the worst folds, and that's what we came to in for the newspapers. Now, there is another kind of fold which you know, and this origami is to know, is Miori folds. And what are these folds? They basically say that, you know, don't put in something which is a 90 degree fold, but put in something which is not a 90 degree fold, okay? And you can look at this Miori kind of foldings, which will basically say that if you want to fold something, it's very easy to fold back. But essentially, all these origami things and all these paper folding things are usually sequential somebody tells you that you have to fold one after the other and then after the other, and if you don't fold in sequence, you will never get the structure. So if you want to fly a plane, you know how you have to do the folds, and all the folds are in sequence. Suppose now I want to do this, I don't want that. I actually want to create something where I don't have to remember the sequences of doing it. It would be wonderful to do that. Okay. So let's just go up and see how to do about it. I will basically skip over the maths, and I'll actually point you out where the maths is and where you can find more about the maths. But essentially, the idea is to get a feel for it. A part of this talk will be recorded because there are some things that I wanted to show you. A part of this talk will be like I speak to you, okay? So this is how we'll do it. So we'll constantly toggle between sharing the screens. So now, this is a problem that we wanted to more 3D curve structures. And what is the idea? Ki aapko ye, like you'll have a paper like this. Aisa koi paper chahiye hame. Aur hame, finally, we want a shape like that. Aisa koi shape we want up here. And let me announce it. Okay, so. And we want a shape from here. We want this shape up here. And we want to do how we get to do it. And this was with Professor Nitin Nitsure. We worked with him. And most of the maths is actually done by him. And if you're interested in these gory details of the maths in the problem, if you just search for this word, he had given two ICL colloquiums, and it's there. So essentially, the maths is actually there. So anyway, let me inspire you with what the problem is and how simple is the approach. So approach ye tha. Okay. So idea ye hai ki you take some paper, which is for practical cases, which is called as a Shrinky Dings. Amazon se milta hai ye. You know that you have a shape like this. This is what you want to do. What the idea is that if, since you know the function, I mean, what is a function? Function tells me is how high is this point from some base plane. Huh? So that's what is a function. It describes the surface. Okay? So what we do is we basically choose a printout of it. So we print this whole thing onto the Shrinky Dings, or we use a conventional laser printer. We heat it under an IR lamp, and we get the shape. Okay? So that's the whole idea. Okay. So this is the shape that you have got. So let me ask you that why are you interested in basically making folded structures? There are multiple reasons for it. One simple reason is that, you know, sometimes if you take a folded structure, say for example this structure is, you know, it's flimsy up here. What I can do is I can fold it like this, and then the same structure becomes rigid. So folding gives you sometimes rigidity in this. The other choices that you can want to get folded is because suppose you want to take something up and you want to pack the whole thing into a small space, tabhi folding a chair. So there are many reasons that you want to fold things. You also might want to wonder that sometimes some things in biology, also biology, natural systems, might start from something which actually looks like a very spherical object, but lands up being an extremely complicated object. This is called as morphogenesis. Technically, it's called morphogenesis, but how do you go from something which is a simple shape to a shape which is very different? You want this, you want to understand this. And if you had a continuous version of this problem, agar aapko pata ho ki kaise karna hai, to maybe you will be able to generalize this problem. So idea ye hai, this is what we wanted to do. Okay, so let me go back and start here. Okay. So I'm going to run this video for you, which is actually a pre-recorded video of mine describing this problem to you, because I needed to do certain experiments in the middle, which I thought that it would be difficult for me to do in real time. But if anybody has any question, we can just take the question.
My first example would be to try and make shapes beginning from a flat sheet.
So you can't hear? Sorry, was it inaudible?
Sir, please play from beginning.
Beginning from a flat sheet or something. What are flat sheets? Paper is a flat sheet.
The video is little bit slow, sir.
Okay.
use a shape. Shape is something that
the volume needs to be.
For example,
please increase volume.
Actually, the volume is at the max. But what I can do is, if it doesn't work, I can just explain to you just straight away. So let me go to the whole point. So before I introduce you to the because I'll use the images, so let me just stick on to this video. So let's just start. Before I start describing what a shape is, let me start describing to you this question of how curve is a curve. Okay, because after all, shape is a three-dimensional and the surface is two-dimensional. So instead of that, I will start with a one-dimensional thing, and because it's just easier for it. So how do you describe how curve is a curve? You take this example that you are on a cycle and you're riding on a road. And essentially, if you ride on a road and the road is straight, what do? You basically hold the handle in a fixed configuration. It's a straight configuration. That's what you do. Okay, so you ride straight. Now, what happens if your road is slightly meandered? Now, if you have to do this, then you have to constantly basically start to toggle your handle from your left to right and left to right, and you'll have to do that, right? So what you do is, the moment you turn the handle, say for example, to a configuration which is slightly left, obviously you'll have to return it to the straight configuration and go to the right to keep moving on the road. But if you do it towards the left, and the very instance that you did to the left, if you do that locking, what we will do is you will basically turn on a circle. Or ye jo circle hai, this is basically your radius of curvature. So if you're turning towards the left, then you basically make a circle along the anticlockwise direction. If you turn it towards the right, you will make a circle in the clockwise direction. So ye aapka positive negative curvature ho gaya. Aur agar aapne ulta turn turn kiya, to aapka wo positive curvature ho gaya. तो ये किया आपने, आपने उल्टा टर्न किया तो ये पॉजिटिव कर्वेचर होगा. तो एक स्ट्रेट लाइन में आपका तो स्ट्रेट है तो कर्वेचर जीरो है. बट इफ यू आर ऑन अ मीएंडरिंग रोड, यू आर कांस्टेंटली टॉगलिंग बिटवीन सम पॉजिटिवली कर्व्ड पार्ट ऑफ योर रोड टू सम नेगेटिवली कर्व्ड पार्ट ऑफ योर रोड. एंड दिस इज हाउ योर साइकिल कांस्टेंटली, यू हैव टू चेंज द ओरिएंटेशन ऑफ द साइकिल. एंड एट एनी इंस्टेंस, कोई भी इंस्टेंस पे अगर आप लॉक कर दीजिए, तो जो वो सर्कल बनाएगा आपका, तो वो होगा उस पॉइंट में कर्व का रेडियस ऑफ कर्वेचर. ये तो कर्वेचर, ये तो स्ट्रेट लाइन की बात हो गई. शेप्स क्या होता है? लेट्स लुक एट द शेप. एक तो सिंपल शेप होता है कि आपका ये फुटबॉल वाला शेप है. यू हैव दिस फुटबॉल, दिस इज सर्टेनली एज अ शेप, इवन इफ यू इंट्यूटिवली से दिस इज अ थ्री डायमेंशनल ऑब्जेक्ट. नाउ लेट मी मेक अ क्वालिफायर अप हियर. ये जो शेप होता है, ये शेप किसको कहते हैं? मे बी दिस इज यूजफुल फॉर अस टू थिंक अबाउट इट. सपोज मैं ये बॉटल लेता हूँ और मैं पूछता हूँ ये बॉटल का शेप क्या है. नाउ आई विल एज्यूम दैट दिस शेप इज समथिंग, जो भी चीज है वो चेंज नहीं करता इफ आई ट्रांसलेट इट और आई रोटेट. ओके, सो इट्स इनवेरिएंट, मतलब ये चेंज नहीं करता अंडर ट्रांसलेशन एंड रोटेशंस ऑफ द सिस्टम. ऑब्वियसली इफ आई टेक द बॉटल एंड गिव यू द बॉटल इन दिस वे, द बॉटल स्टिल रिमेंस अ बॉटल. सो ये फुटबॉल है, ये कुछ और भी ऑर्किड जैसा कुछ एक चीज हो सकता है, ऐसा कुछ एक चीज होता है, इसका भी एक शेप है. एंड हाउ आर दिस टू शेप्स डिफरेंट फ्रॉम ईच अदर? सो हाउ वुड आई एसोसिएट कर्वेचर टू सम सर्फेस? तो हम लोग क्या करना पड़ेगा उसको? So we will do a little small trick experiment, and this experiment is like this. Let me get back to this whole thing. I don't know what I'm saying here, but suppose I did this experiment, okay? And the experiment is like this: that you start from a point A. Now you're on a flat piece of paper, okay? And what you do is you start walking from the point A to point B. मैदान में आप हैं, आप एक point A and point B you go, and you basically take some 100 steps, okay? Now you've counted your steps. Now, you know, irrespective of the surface that you are in, locally, you know what is a 90 degree. So you turn from at the point B, you turn in an anti-clockwise direction, left-handed tarika se, aap ek 90 degree turn le lijiye. So you take, you make a 90 degree turn. Now you are at point B and you've taken a turn and you're now facing point C. You walk 100 steps again towards point C. At the point C, what you do, you stop and you turn and you move to the point D. Okay. Again at point D, you take a left-hand turn, and again get 100 steps, you will reach to the point A. And it's not surprise. Basically, it's basically you're traversing a square on a flat piece. Now, suppose I did the same experiment, but then I took this particular object. Okay. So what do? I start from one point here. I move 100 steps up here. I move 100 steps here. I move 100 steps here. I move 100 steps here. And every time, मैं क्या करता हूँ कि जब मैं turn लेता हूँ, मैं locally जो जिस line से मैं आ रहा था, उसके respect में मैं left-handed turn ले रहा हूँ और 90 degree turn ले रहा हूँ. That I can always do, right? So now if you do this, this is what you get. So you start at the point A, आप point P पे जाते हैं, B पे 90 degree turn लेते हैं, आप point C में जाते हैं, C में 90 degree turn लेते हैं, point D में जाते हैं, and every path patch in this distance is exactly the same length. आप D पे 90 degree turn लेते हैं और आप point E में आ जाते हैं. And you realize that if it's a curved surface, then your point D, A and E, मतलब starting और ending दो अलग points हो जाएंगे. Now this is a telltale signature of curvature. अगर आपको कोई पूछे कि curvature क्या है, कि surface में आप हैं, now surface, this is a beautiful part of the curvature that you can tell about the curvature by being on the surface. आप एक चिमटा हो, for example, you know, चिमटा क्या करें, चिमटे पे, this is the tongs that you have, and your ant you are, so basically the ant can only walk on the tong. And for an ant, he doesn't know the space outside, so he's only on the tong, but if by walking and doing these little small circles here and there, squares, paths, closed paths here and there, you can always find out what is the curved surface or the curvature of the surface that he, that ant is basically in. Okay. So, ye experiment hai, ye aap kar sakte hai curvature nikalne ke liye. So, positive curvature kya hota hai? Agar A and E ka jo vector hai, isko condensed matter physics mein Burgers vector bola jata hai. Ye jo vector hai, ye vector ka agar direction ulta ho jayega, matlab E agar E yahan pe aa jayega, so let me just see, you can see probably the screen. ये पॉइंट है जहां पे अगर यहां पे आ जाता तो देन यू वुड सी दैट देयर इज अ दिस अ नेगेटिवली कर्व सरफेस. अब पॉजिटिव कर्वेचर नेगेटिव कर्वेचर का एक और भी सिंपल तरीका है समझने का, और ये समझना ये ऐसी है कि अगर आप एक सर्कल लेते हो, इसलिए सपोज लेट मी टेक दिस पर्टिकुलर पीस राइट, एंड व्हाट हैपेंस इज आई मूव अ डिस्टेंस आर फ्रॉम द सेंटर. सो ये मेरा सेंटर है, इस डिस्टेंस में मैं आर मूव करता हूं. And then by keeping this distance constant, if I move on a circle or a, if this is a locus, then I know this locus of all the points whose distances are equal from the center will trace out a circle. Badhiya hai. So if you get this circle up there, you know the perimeter of the circle. Well, you've learned this. This is 2 pi r. This fundamental theorem doesn't work if you're on a curved surface. And you can guess this why. Because agar aap yahan se ho, and if you walk, say, for example, this distance up here, and then by keeping this constant, you start to move in this direction. Aise move karte hain aap. So then you will transcribe this circle. And this circle's perimeter is given by not this distance, but it's given by that distance. Okay? And essentially, you will find that for a positively curved surface, iska jo perimeter hoga, wo 2 pi r se kam hoga. And jo negatively curved surface hota hai, uska jo perimeter hota hai, wo 2 pi r se zyada hota hai. Now let me try and see if I can pull out an experiment for you. Basically, if you try and, I cannot, but if you try and see some plastic, suppose you tear any piece of plastic, you will find that the edges of this plastic, you see this edges is basically wrinkled out. Yeah, I don't know whether I can see it or not, but these edges are wrinkled out. You can try it out. You know, you tear any piece of plastic by your hand, and you will find that the edges are always wrinkled. The reason they are wrinkled is, yahan pe kya hota hai ki at this distance, your length is much larger. Aapne stretch kiya na, usko to wo lamba ho gaya. But itna lamba cheez usko, andar ka jo part hai, wo to stretch nahi hua. So basically, this long thing has to basically fit into a smaller region. And what does it do to fit into a smaller region? It basically does an undulation. So, height mein fluctuate karna shuru karta hai. Isiliye, if you look at flowers, most of these flowers are these floppy ends at the edges, right? Though they go up and down. Those are negatively curved surfaces. In negatively curved surfaces, the same argument. You take a point from the center, you make a circle. Basically, what you will do is, you will circumscribe a distance, r 2 pi r, a perimeter, which is going to be greater than 2 pi r. Obviously, ye jo maine khicha to agar main east length pe chahunga to upar jayega niche jayega mera length to zyada hai na. So we will use this whole idea to mold out shapes, and we'll do something more also, but let's do this. So let me just go, if I can, so let me just go up here and see if I can just point out something to you. Okay, this is a good idea. So this is what I was trying to tell you for a positively curved surface. Ki aap pehle se ye distance measure kijiye aur fir ye wala circle ko draw kar dijiye yahan pe. Uska 2 pi r ye wala perimeter nikal lijiye. Aur fir then you take that same distance and put it onto a flat piece of paper and then turn it round, and you will find that this circle, this perimeter, this up here, this perimeter is going to be larger than this perimeter. Okay, so this is a circle which is actually much smaller than the circle which I had drawn on the flat piece of paper. Aur ye bahut sa famous theorem hai Burton Dewey Poisson theorem, and basically ye karta kya hai, ye curvature hai, ye Gaussian curvature hai. Main ye nahi bol raha hu aapko Gaussian curvature kya hai, but kind of is a quantifier for descriptor for your curved surfaces. Aur yahi curvature positive ya negative hota hai. If your c of r is greater than 2 pi r, jo negatively curved surface hai, c of r hai ye wala circumference, to aapka ye 2 pi r minus c of r negative hoga aur ye negative curved surface honge. Agar c of r ye chota hai aapka 2 pi r se, then you will get a positively curved surface. Okay, the same argument goes for your area also, and if you are interested, you can see one goes like r cube. Limit case hai, ye 1 by r cube hota hai, dusre 1 by r to the power 4 hota hai. You might worry about why it is so, and there is a factors also which is interesting, where there is a 3 up there and there is a 12 up there. Okay, anyway, so I will, this PowerPoint has crashed, so anyway, while it starts, so what you do is, now if you want to just get to this point, so idea ye hoga ki aapka, so what basically you know is that I will have to, let me just get back to this point if I can. Let me take this particular example, and the reason I am showing you this particular example is this is a cones example. So cone mein kya karenge, ki ye cheez hai maine aapko pehle hi bata diya tha ki aise koi ek 45 degree mein aap ye ek cheez karenge aur fir scissors lenge aur scissors se isko cut kar denge. और ये लिया, ये जोन लगा दिया, this is this, you have got a cone. But suppose you don't have a cone, but you have something which is a slightly different shape. You will see that there is a difficulty in what the tailor does. Tailor क्या करता है आपका? वही तो करता है, वो कपड़ा लेके जाता है. You bring him a flat piece of cloth. He cuts various pieces of it and he stitches them, and then you get your cloth, right? So essentially, this cutting and this kind of a stitching doesn't actually work for everything, and for I'll give you an example for that. Suppose aapne ye karne ki koshish kiya, now I want to make this particular shape. Now what do I do with this particular shape? And I'll tell you what this picture at the bottom is. So essentially what this picture at the bottom is to say that main karta kya hu, main I will start from the center. So this is my center point, huh? And this is the arc that I'm moving along in this direction. So ye kya hai, ye center point hai aur is direction mein main move kar raha hu, theek hai. थोड़ा मूव करता हूं, ये पहला वाला सर्कल मिलता है मुझको. आई मूव अलोंग दिस सर्कल एंड आई फाइंड व्हाट इज द 2 पाई आर, व्हाट इज बेसिकली द सर्कमफेरेंस. और मैं नई डिस्टेंस इसके ऊपर मूव करता हूं, एंड देन आई मूव अलोंग दिस डायरेक्शन टिल आई हिट टू दैट सेम वैल्यू ऑफ सर्कमफेरेंस. सो 2 पाई आर से ये सर्कमफेरेंस अलग होगा, देन आई बेसिकली मार्क दैट पोर्शन एज ब्लैक. आई मूव अलोंग इन स्लाइटली मोर डायरेक्शन, सो कहीं पे यहां पे आता हूं एंड आई मेक अनदर सर्कमफेरेंशियल डायरेक्शन यहाँ पे, तो ये पे जो चक्कर लगाता हूँ यहाँ पे, कहीं यहाँ पे जाके मैं एक चक्कर लगाता हूँ, एंड आई फाइंड दैट दैट्स अ सी ऑफ आर, सम पेरिमीटर आई कैन मेजर इट अप. उतना ही डिस्टेंस मैं यहाँ पे लेके जाता हूँ एंड आई स्टार्ट मूविंग इट इन दिस पर्टिकुलर डायरेक्शन, एंड आई फाइंड दैट आई हैव एंडेड अप हियर, and some extra part is left. What was this extra part? This is the extra part that I have cut it off just for you now. Okay. But unlike the cone, ये जो extra part है, ये extra part curved है. मतलब इसका जो जो ये यहाँ पे कोन का फायदा क्या था? कोन एक्चुअली एक फिक्स्ड एंगल सेंटर में जिस जो चीज मैंने कट कर दिया था वो एक फिक्स्ड एंगल सेंटर में सब्टेंड कर रहा था. इसमें क्या है, एंगल चेंज कर रहा है. नाउ इफ यू वांट टू कट इट एंड आई कैन शो यू आई ट्राइड डूइंग दिस वेल दिस इज सम शेप लाइक दैट एंड यू वांट टू ट्राई टू जॉइन इट वोंट जस्ट जॉइन बिकॉज डिफरेंट पार्ट्स हैव टू कॉन्ट्रैक्ट डिफरेंटली फॉर दिस टू एक्चुअली टू जॉइन. फिर आप क्या करेंगे, दर्जी के पास ले जाके ये आइडिया तो काम नहीं करने वाला है. देन यू हैव टू डू समथिंग एल्स एंड व्हाट वी डू इज वी बेसिकली कॉन्ट्रैक्ट आउट दोज स्पेसेस. एंड हाउ डू वी कॉन्ट्रैक्ट आउट दोज स्पेसेस एंड रिमेंबर व्हाट वी कैन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इज दैट वी डोंट डू एन यूनिफॉर्म कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. मतलब हर जगह एक ही जैसा कॉन्ट्रैक्ट नहीं कर रहा है, कुछ कुछ जगह ज्यादा कॉन्ट्रैक्ट करता है, कुछ कुछ ज्यादा कम कॉन्ट्रैक्ट करता है. और ये करते कैसे है, तो ये एक बाजार में एक चीज मिलता है विच वी कॉल अ श्रिंकेडिंग्स. अब श्रिंकेडिंग्स क्या होता है कि आपका रबर फॉर एग्जाम्पल, the reason that rubber is a great material is because aap usually solid state physics aise koi kitab physics mein ke kitab mein kaise padhte hain elasticity ke bare mein. You think that there is a spring aur wo spring kahan se aata hai, ki atoms hai, atom dono atoms ke beech mein interaction hai, you try to pull this apart, then basically there is an energy goes up and it pulls back. Kitna aap stretch kar sakte hai koi bhi string ko, basically you have done this Young's modulus experiments. It's hardly 1%, 2%, 3% you can actually change, maybe 10%, maybe that's maximum. But ek rubber liji itna lamba chain khich sakte hai. How does that work? Basically that works for a very different reason. Rubber mein kya hota hai ki aapka polymer chains hota hai, wo entangled tarika se rehta hai. So you basically have an entanglement of these chains, and what you do is when you're stretching them up, then these all these chains become straight. Aur thermodynamics ka ek rule hai, वो ये बोलता है कि अगर आपका सिस्टम का एंट्रोपी घट जाता है, एंट्रोपी मतलब कितनी तरीके से काउंट करते हैं आप, फॉर एग्जाम्पल लेट मी गिव दिस एन एग्जाम्पल, कि अगर मेरे पास एक स्ट्रेट स्ट्रिंग है, अगर आपके पास एक स्ट्रेट स्ट्रिंग है, इससे कितना कॉन्फ़िगरेशन है, ये तो कॉन्फ़िगरेशन है इसका, बट अगर मेरे पास एक टेढ़ा मेढ़ा करके एक स्प्रिंग है, कॉइल्ड अप स्प्रिंग है, तो उसका कितना कॉन्फ़िगरेशन है, बहुत सारे कॉन्फ़िगरेशन है. डिपेंड्स अपॉन हाउ यू हैव एक्चुअली यू थिंक अपॉन वूल, हाउ मेनी कॉन्फ़िगरेशन कैन यू थिंक अपॉन वूल. कॉन्फ़िगरेशन मीन्स कैसे देखने, अगर फोटो एक फोटो उठाया, दूसरा फोटो उठाया, तीसरा फोटो उठाया, हर फोटो में अलग अलग दिखेगा. मम्मी कैसे उसको करता है या आपका भाई कैसे उसको करता है, उसके ऊपर डिपेंड करता है एग्जैक्टली कि वो स्ट्रक्चर कैसा है. ऑन द अदर हैंड इफ यू होल्ड समथिंग स्ट्रेट, तो एक ही कॉन्फ़िगरेशन है. तो जब आप कोई रबर को स्ट्रेच करते हो तो बेसिकली क्या होता है कि ये रबर जो है वो एक लो एंट्रोपी कॉन्फ़िगरेशन में चला जाता है. जैसे ही आप इसको छोड़ देते हो वो वापस से लो कॉन्फ़िगरेशन, हाई एंट्रोपिक कॉन्फ़िगरेशन में वापस आ जाता है. इसलिए रबर को बहुत खींचा जा सकता है एंड फ्रॉम देयर द रबर बेसिकली कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स टू अ स्मॉल लेंथ. नाउ व्हाट यू कैन डू इज यू कैन डू द सिमिलर थिंग फॉर अ मटेरियल व्हिच इज लाइक अ श्रिंकेडिंग. सो व्हाट यू डू इज यू स्ट्रेच द रबर आउट एंड देन सडनली स्क्वीज द रबर, टेक इट टू अ टेम्परेचर वेयर एवरीथिंग इज फ्रोजन. अगर एवरीथिंग इज फ्रोजन, सो बेसिकली व्हाट यू हैव डन इज यू हैव फ्रोजन the low entropy state of a rubber in the system. जैसे ही आप उसको heat करते हो, heat कैसे करते हो, selective heat कैसे करते हो? Because if you draw something black, you know black places get more hotter than the white places. So black क्या होगा? वो absorb करेगा. So you use a physiotherapy lamp. वो black portion जैसे ही absorb करेगा, what will you get? You will basically get that region to go in. Now the system can now contract because वो now they are not frozen. Now all these high entropy springs can actually come down. As soon as they come down, they will actually try to contract. Ye hai physics is the idea. So let me just see if I can show you the video for this. Now let's go to the next one. Wow, it is again crashes. Okay. It looks like it's going to crash all the way down. Give me a minute. So, let me just. So, ऐसे जैसे आप हिट करते हो, you see this that it actually goes up. जैसे आप हिट करते हो, ये चीज ऊपर जाता है. And then after some time, because it has become hot, it contracts out. So this is the whole idea. Now, what do? We take this shrinky dink. I've told you how to bring patterns. And the idea of making the pattern was to figure out what is the deficit that I have to take away from the system. So that's what we do. We print a pattern onto the shrinky dinks. Or phir isko garam karte, and then this is what you get. So ye jo shrinky dink hai, isko maine laser printer se print kiya. Ye particular ek shape hai. Ye shape mujhe negatively curved surface dega. So essentially what you'll do is, as I heat it, you will see that you will get, if you look into this part, you will start seeing that this will actually give you a negatively curved surface. So jaise garam hota hai wo, this thing actually starts to give you a negatively curved surface. You can do it for a positively curved surface. For example, this is a different printing. You can just see that, you know, this printing pattern is going to be very different from a different fitting printing pattern. Or jaise aap isko heat karte ho, to basically kya karta hai ye cheez, ye positively curved surface pe pahunch jata hai. So this is basically getting into a positively curved surface. So ye cheez aap bahut sare cheezon ke liye kar sakte ho, bahut sare shapes ke liye kar sakte ho, bahut sare generic cheezon ke liye kar sakte ho. Let me put you one more example to this. You know, when you start thinking about geometry and how you can see, because geometry is all around the place. So suppose I asked you this question ki aapko aapke paas ek ball hai aur is ball ko aapko ek paper se cover karna hai. And you know that this will never be possible, because of what will happen, the paper will actually crumple if you want to cover it up. So this was a question which Chebyshev had been, mathematician the, he had been forced that ki koi bhi cheez aapke paas ho, उसको क्लॉथ से अगर आपको ड्रेप करना हो, कवर करना हो, तो आप कैसे करें कि आपके पास रिंकल ना हो. सो द आइडिया दैट ही केम अप विद इज दिस, यू कैन टाइल इट विद स्क्वायर्स, पेंटागन, सॉरी स्क्वायर्स एंड पैरेललोग्राम्स इन सच अ वे दैट यू कैन एक्चुअली डू अ वेरी नाइस टाइलिंग ऑफ इट. दिस इज कॉल्ड अ चेबीशेव टाइलिंग. बट यू कैन ऑल्सो नो, फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अगर आप मोजा पर पहनते हैं, इस मोजा इज बेसिकली वेल्ट और एनी कॉटन, राइट? एंड इफ यू वेयर इट, देन व्हेरेवर यू हैव कर्वेचर्स ऑन योर बॉडी, यू विल फाइंड दैट दोस प्लेसेस आर दोस स्क्वायर्स. इनिशियली दे वर स्क्वायर, दे हैव गॉट स्लाइटली डिस्टॉर्टेड. वो डिस्टॉर्टेड हो जाता है. अगर आपको पता हो, सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल, ये तो यू हैव ऑलवेज सीन, राइट? ये फ्रूट्स आता है इस तरीके से पैक किया हुआ. If you take the fruit out, then basically they collapse and give you one structure. The moment you put the fruit in, you basically get a very different kind of a structure. तो ये जो चीज है, ये यूज करके इसको बेसिकली मेट्रिक बोला जाता है. तो एसेंशियली क्या होता है कि अगर आपके पास फ्लैट स्क्वायर है, तो आपका जो ये जो डीएसएस स्क्वायर है, मतलब दो पॉइंट्स पे डिस्टेंस क्या है, वो डीएक्स स्क्वायर प्लस डीवाई स्क्वायर. पाइथागोरियन फॉर्मूला यूज किया जाता है. अगर आपके पास एक ऐसा चीज है कि हर चीज स्क्वायर नहीं है, मतलब दी स्क्वायर्स हैव गॉट डिस्टॉर्टेड, देन ऑब्वियसली लाइक ए प्लस बी होल स्क्वायर का फॉर्मूला जैसा, यू विल गेट टर्म्स इन विच एक्स एंड वाई विल बी मिक्स. So you will get dx square will be some function e dx square 2f dx dy g y square. ऐसे एक function मिलता है, ये metric बोला जाता है, Riemannian metric बोला जाता है technically. And suppose I gave you the function, जिस function को target है, जिस shape को आप लेके जा सकते हो, वो function अगर आपको पता हो, तो you can actually calculate out at every point x and y, e f and g is going to be different. What are those values of e f and g? And then you know in our ways you can actually figure out कि आप कैसे करेंगे कि वो जो मेट्रिक है, वो ये जो आपका जो मैं श्रिंकी डिंक बोला था, उसमें आप क्या करेंगे कि वो मेट्रिक एम्बेडेड हो जाएगा. अगर वो एम्बेडेड मेट्रिक एम्बेड हो गया उसके ऊपर और अगर हमने हिट किया, तो बेसिकली इट विल ट्राई एंड टेक द शेप ऑफ दैट. एक तीसरा तरीका हो सकता है इसको बनाने का, एंड दिस प्रॉब्लम यू हैव सीन. व्हाट यू डू इज यू स्टार्ट, सो यू हैव अ थ्री डायमेंशनल स्ट्रक्चर कोई भी, ये तो आपने देखा होगा कहीं और पे, ये जो पिक्चर्स है यहाँ पे, सो बेसिकली मोड़ा जैसा पिक्चर है. So if you think of every point, these rods are connected to each other. And if I say that these rods are our set of points, and main ye points ko rigidly bolna chahta hu, to what is important in this point? It's basically to say if I have x, y, z, these are the three coordinates that I have. I basically from that point, main kya karunga? Main distances fix karne ki koshish karunga. Main wo point se ek aur point ka distance fix karunga, usse aur dusra point ka distance fix karunga. Aur if enough constraints agar maine de diya system mein, to yehi cheez hoga. To ye typically kya karte hai? You basically lay them as a grid. ऐसा एक ग्रिड होता है, फिर आप उसको खींच के ऊपर ले जाते हो, एंड देन यू बेसिकली गेट दिस शेप ऑन द प्रॉब्लम. वी आल्सो इंप्लीमेंटेड द सेम थिंग, व्हिच इज टू डू अ डिस्टेंस मोल्डिंग इन योर सिस्टम. तो आइडिया ये था कि क्वेश्चन तो बहुत सिंपल था कि आपको शेप कैसे मॉडिफाई करना है, एक फ्लैट शीट लेके एक कर्व शेप पे. पर जो मैथ्स होता है इसके अंदर, वो काफी से कॉम्प्लिकेटेड होता है और कॉम्प्लेक्स होता है, और बहुत सारा इंटरेस्टिंग चीज दिखाया जाता है रखता है इसमें. So people who are interested in differential geometries and things like that, this is a mathematical bend hai ki ye sab cheez janna hai inke liye poor man's way of understanding what this curved spaces are because curved spaces physics mein bahut important role play karta hai but curved spaces theoretically aata hai usually very rarely do we play with curved spaces and have an intuitive feeling for those curved spaces is kisam ke experiments ye curved spaces ko clearly bolta hai ki kaise kis tarika se ab ye curved spaces ko use kar sakte hain how do you understand them and how do you get some utility out of these curved spaces in this course of this whole thing we also discovered few new things which we'd never understood things in curvature which were absolutely new we figured out there was a very deep connection between maine aapko bol diya ki metric kya hai metric dss ka distance hai ye metric ke sath shape ka kya connection hai ye hame samajh mein aaya and let me not get into details but there are some very intricate problems that comes out while you are studying a very very simple problem this is not a complicated problem at all how much time do I have how much time do I have
at least 10 more minutes
okay fine great so let me do the next thing is this that we have another thing which is called as a granular physics so ye thoda shift karte hain gears aur ye jo experiment aapko main bolne wala hu wo aap ghar pe dekhte hain aap ye experiment jo satyen ne describe karenge aapko this is an experiment which you see every day on your dining table and this experiment is something to do with the way your toothpicks are arranged Have you ever looked the way at the toothpicks are arranged? कभी घर पे जाके देखिए कि जैसे टूथपिक होता है ना उसका अरेंजमेंट कैसे होता है आपको दिखेगा कि वो एक बहुत अच्छा सा इंटरेस्टिंग कैरेक्टर होता है उसका उसका कैरियल कैरेक्टर होता है उसमें और बहुत डिटर्मिनिस्टिक होता है देखने में बहुत सुंदर लगता है यू माइट आस्क दैट इज दिस इंटरेस्टिंग एंड व्हाट वी कैन लर्न फ्रॉम इट सो लेट मी जस्ट प्ले दिस स्मॉल वीडियो फॉर इट आई होप दिस विल रन
हाय आई एम पुतना आई एम अ पीएचडी स्टूडेंट वर्किंग विमिन 30 लेट मी शो यू समथिंग कूल Last week, I bought a box of toothpicks from the local market. They had this beautiful picture of toothpicks arranged in intricate patterns on their stickers. Where did these patterns come from? Did someone go and arrange each toothpick by hand to get such beautiful designs? As physicists, we are often interested in how a collection of discrete particles behave when they are under the influence of external forces. These discrete particles can only interact with each other through local interactions such as friction, formation of contacts, compressing, or a mix of all the above. The strength of these local interactions between individual particles dictate what properties we observe of the whole collection. Let's consider a very simple example. I have a box of steel balls and I have a box of sand. I put the two onto a surface from some small height. I can see that the sand forms a very beautiful pile. However, the balls simply bounce on the surface and go all over the place. What's happening here? If we zoom in, we can see that the grains of sand are very irregularly shaped. These irregularly shaped grains can interlock with each other like puzzle pieces. Because of their friction, the pile's shape is constant. However, in the case of the steel balls, they are smooth spherical objects. The contacts between them are very tiny point contacts, and these contacts cannot provide enough friction to hold the balls together. In the case of the toothpick, when you buy a new box, it's very tightly packed with all the new toothpicks inside. As you keep using the toothpicks and throwing them away, spaces are created inside the box and the toothpicks can move about. What's happening is that every single toothpick is a very narrow cylindrical rod resting on a very tiny base. They want to topple over so as to minimize the gravitational potential energy. Within this container, they can only move around so much as is allowed by the empty spaces around it. So the toothpicks move around and arrange themselves in such a way that the whole collection's potential energy is minimized, even if the potential energy of each rod is not minimized. Such a process where individual microscopic particles interact with each other and give rise to a global macroscopic property is known as self-organization. As mentioned earlier, we are also interested in how these collections of particles behave under the influence of external forces. Here, in this box of toothpicks, I have painted a single toothpick red so that you can easily see it. When I start tapping this box from below, you can see that the red toothpick is moving around along the walls of the container. This means that all the rods are rotating within the container along its walls. So my system is able to convert energy that I'm putting in the vertical direction into a rotational current. And this is only possible because of the local interaction between each of these rods. The great thing about studying collections of discrete particles like these is that the systems are very readily available, and anybody can do an experiment and start to get immediate results. Why don't you get started today?
So that was Satyanu explaining to you. Okay, so this is a very cool experiment. You can try it at home. Essentially, what you do is just do char fek dijiye niche se and you start tapping it. Jaise aap tap karna shuru karenge, you realize that force pe jis direction mein force tha, usually displacement us direction mein hota hai. यहाँ पे आपको टोटली एक कैरल करंट मिलेगा. ये करंट इस तरफ से हो सकता है, उस तरफ से हो सकता है, डिपेंड करता है कि आपका डायरेक्शन क्या है. सो यू नो वी कैन फॉर अस इट इज इंटरेस्टिंग बिकॉज देयर इज स्पॉन्टेनियस सिमेट्री ब्रेकिंग और ये सब चीज है, बट यू कैन गेट स्टार्टेड विद इट, यू कैन गेट स्टार्टेड बाय लुकिंग एट इट. सो एसेंशियली दैट वाज सत्यन्यूज व्यू पॉइंट ऑन इट. मैं आई विल कम टू द नेक्स्ट एक्सपेरिमेंट व्हिच इज आल्सो वेरी सिंपल. सो सपोज आई डोंट नो वेदर मेनी ऑफ यू ड्राइव, but if you drive and if you are driving on a, so let me just say, try and expand it. If you are driving on, say for example, some uphill road, you have a problem because if you're not careful, you will bump into the next guy in front of you and there will be a chaos on the road. Okay, how do you do this? You do say something by something which is called the feathering the clutch. So essentially halka sa clutch ke clutch or brake, clutch brake, clutch brake karke aap ye karte ho. Now, this is where आप constantly toggle करते हो दो frictional states में. होता क्या है कार में कि you have a engine which is moving, okay, and a clutch plate होता है, वो wheel को engage करता है gearbox के साथ या disengage करता है. जैसे आप clutch को दबा देते हैं तो ये जो wheel है और जो gearbox है इसका disengagement हो जाता है. Then your wheel is free to rotate, okay. If you put the clutch plate on, then you're basically in a high friction state और उसको lock कर देते. तो ये जो टॉगलिंग है वो बेसिकली करता है कि पावर ट्रांसमिशन, कितना पावर मैं इंजन से मैं ट्रांसमिट कर रहा हूं व्हील्स पे, इसके ऊपर कंट्रोल करना. तो ये जो कंट्रोल है ये फिजिक्स में बहुत, इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स में एटलीस्ट बहुत आसान तरीके से किया जा सकता है. यू नो पीपल हु आर स्लाइटली ओल्डर वुड रियलाइज दैट पहले के जमाने में यू वुड हैव दिस रेगुलेटर्स व्हिच वुड बी वेरी बिग रेगुलेटर्स, फैन रेगुलेटर्स. अब क्या है, फैन रेगुलेटर्स आर स्मॉल. Earlier, what they used to do is they would have big resistors and they would do a resistance drop. You see, this is how they would drop the current. इसलिए वो fan regulator गर्म हो जाता, फट भी जाता था. But now what they do is they say, okay, AC signal है, AC signal को partially on करूँगा और partially off करूँगा. वैसे gear clutch braking करने के लिए. So what you do is you clutch it and then you leave it and then you clutch it and you leave it. The moment you clutch it, the wheel is disengaged. यहाँ पे क्या होगा? Current is switched off. And moment you disengage the clutch in this condition, as if the diode is on, and basically you basically get the current. Yeah, idea. Yeah, pulse width modulation is a very powerful tool in electronics engineering. Would you be able to do some analog of this in mechanical engineering? क्या friction को toggle किया जा सकता है? And I'll show you a simple video of where you can do this. And though this is Satyanu, this is Shoman, and I'm not sure that again his video will.
Hi, I'm Shoman from Mimi30 Lab. And today I'll be talking about an interesting experiment inspired by ball bearings. Bearings are used to reduce the friction between two mechanical parts that are in relative motion against each other and support loads by transferring them from one part to another. There are many different types of bearings. One of the most commonly used are ball bearings. Ball bearings are used to provide smooth, low friction motion in applications involving rotational motion. A typical ball bearing is composed of.
So let me stop here and explain because I think the audio is again low. So what happens is you use the ball bearings, and the ball bearing is basically something where you want to have a shaft which is moving, and then you're coupling it to something else, and you want the friction, and the friction is low. Why is the friction low? Because you have these balls which are rolling with respect, but they're not connect, they're not touching each other because they're in sockets. Suppose we did something else in this system and we replaced this socket that you had in a different way so that we could get into this toggling state. And I'll tell you how simple is it to get to the toggling state.
One race is...
Let me just do it for you. Let me just take you the most interesting part of the...
The load is up to boy.
Okay. Look at this particular picture.
It reduces the contact friction between them.
Okay, look at this picture. What I have done is a very simple thing. These are basically Fevicol tubes. Okay, this is just for illustration. You know, the paper has something which is very different and more complicated. But just look at the demonstration. What do? Is I basically take these rollers and I mark lines on them and I put a sponge on the top of it. Okay, and if the normal force is small, what happens is very simple. If you start pushing it,
such a sponge is pressed on top of some objects, you can see that the sponge gets deformed over them. If we now apply a moderate,
so the moment you have this normal force coming here, you look at it, then there is a sponge is getting deformed over it, and this deformation is almost acting like sockets, which is holding the balls together. This is almost like sockets in ball bearing.
Force on the sponge and move it, the objects will roll, which can be seen from the rotation of the black lines.
So now, if you see if you are moving it, at least at here, they're all rolling. Okay. Now what I do is I increase the normal force. If you increase the normal force, you see that the balls are actually being squished together. This there's a lot of deformation of the your sponge up here.
If we apply a very large force on the sponge and then try to move it, the objects will mostly slide, which can also be seen from the.
So now the objects only slide. Okay. So this is a cool thing. Just by toggling the normal force, you can change the system from going from a rolling state to a sliding state. So the idea of a ball bearing in the last 100 years have never been altered. This is the same size of ball bearings that you actually have. So what we did was we actually took the ball bearing, modified the ball bearing to have one layer which is slightly soft, and which by using the normal force now you can toggle between the frictional states. So you're allowed to choose any value of friction and you don't have to actually go on and off, but you can dynamically choose a value of friction which allows you to have the right coupling between two mechanical systems. So that's an interesting way of looking at things, because what we do is we also use many particle physics in such kinds of systems. We also played around with optical tweezers. Now I'm switching gears just to tell what we do. And one of these optical tweezers is basically to trap a particle and then, you know, apply forces on it and then measure the forces accurately. But what you can also do is you can shape the optical, the wavefront. And if you shape the wavefront, you will see some very interesting things. Now you can start making machines which are at very small scales. And I'll show you a small machine which is at a very small scale. It's like a ball bearing, which is at an entirely very tiny scale. Okay, so how do you do that? And this is Harsh, and I'll allow him to say.
Hi, I'm Harsh from BB30 Lab. Let's talk about optical tweezers. This is how a 100x objective lens looks like, which magnifies an image 100 times. We can see a smaller lens in the front and a larger lens at the back that can very tightly focus our laser light. By tightly focusing light, this is how we create an optical tweezer that attracts the surrounding particles. We know that when light passes through the thicker middle portions of a convex lens, it encounters more path. We can see a planar wavefront coming in from the left that becomes a concave wavefront after passing through the lens. A spatial light modulator is a device which can change the wavefront of light to simulate any lens or diffraction grating or a general optical element. A spatial light modulator effectively looks like a camera sensor. We can see the associated circuitry. It consists of an array of liquid crystals whose orientation can be controlled. And therefore, we can control whether light travels through a lot of path or very little path. We can also simulate diffraction grating, and therefore, an incoming light will be reflected onto a central maxima. In fact, we can have multiple diffraction gratings, and we can mix up and put them together on our spatial light modulator. So instead of a single central maxima, we will now have two maximas, and therefore we can create two traps to trap different particles. In fact, we can have an array of traps where we can trap a lot of particles. Not only point traps, we can also have line or a circle as a trap on which we can constrain our particles. This is how our experimental setup looks like. You can see a laser which emits infrared light. This infrared light is not visible to the eyes, but it can be caught by the camera. After passing through a bunch of mirrors, it finally reaches our target region, which is a spatial light modulator. After getting modulated to the target shape, it gets further reflected and we guide it into our microscope. We can place our microparticles on a slide and place them on top of an objective to control with an optical tweezer. Let's see the different kind of patterns that we can place on our spatial light modulator to obtain different kinds of traps. On the left hand side, we have a grating which gives a central maxima to control a particle in a single trap. Whereas on the right hand side, we see a Laguerre Gaussian beam, which not only traps the particle on a circle, but also provides a force along the tangent of that circle. Let's have a look at some experimental data. You can see a circular trap, which we generate with our infrared laser. We can also block the infrared light from our camera and only look at the particle which is moving along the circular trap. We can also trap multiple particles. In this case, we see two particles moving along the circular trap. And here we can see lots and lots of particles moving along a circle.
So that's Harsh, who was explaining to you how you can use optical traps. And the reason we use optical traps is sometimes it's most of the things that you study in granular systems, you don't have the role of temperature. And how do you figure out whether something has a role of temperature or not? You know that there are two competing forces, gravity, for example, MGH, and you connect it to KBT. And if you find that the gravity wins over the whole problem, then you say it's athermal. The temperature is not going to play any role in this system. For example, this phone, you know, what is the room temperature? That has nothing to play role. Have no role to play about with this macroscopic center of mass motion of this particle. But suppose you want to randomize things and you want to understand them in that domain, then you want to get into scales which are tiny, which are not at the atomic scales, but essentially the scales of microns, and you get lots of kicks and jitters from all the molecules close by to it, and they give you stochasticity or fluctuation-driven systems, and those are very interesting systems per se to study. And this becomes like, these are experiments which probably you can't do at home. But you know, even once you go to places where they have these tools, you can actually use them. But we also do a lot of this instrumentation in our lab. And we kind of are sold onto this idea that we develop things left and right. You know, all the students in the lab basically build their equipment in a scale of 1 month, 2 months, and then break down that equipment and build something else. And this is because you never know as an experimentalist, what do you need? For example, I'll show you an experiment here. And don't worry about what the experiment is, but you'll suddenly realize there is a problem with imaging in this experiment. And the problem is that I would rather want to see whatever is happening to that object from all angles. And how do I do it? Because my camera is fixed. Now, if I wanted to rotate a camera, it's not easy to rotate a camera because you see, if you rotate a camera, then there are cables up there. The cables will get entangled. There are all kinds of things. Plus, essentially, often what you want to do is you want to get a very large field of view, but you also want to get a very high resolution. And any one of us who has used any camera, mobile camera or anything, this doesn't work this way. Because if you have a very large field of view, if you want to image the whole sky, you basically don't have almost any resolution. Your resolution is in angles, right? So essentially this doesn't work. But you know, as an experimentalist, we are greedy. We want to build it up. We also don't want to pay prices. How do you go about doing with this? I'll give you a simple example of how to do about it. I'll not tell you how actually tricky it is to actually get this thing all working. The idea is that if you want to do this, your camera has this called as a panorama view. What you do is switch on the panorama view, move along with yourself. And essentially, if you do that, then you can get a panorama view or 360 degree view of a place. The problem is not everything is snapped at the same time. So there is a time synchronization problem. So as you are moving on the panorama, things are get delayed. You know, things, a person might have moved somewhere else. You wanted to take the simultaneous events of all the particles at the same time or whatever the events at the same time. This is not possible in a panorama view. Suppose you do something else. The next one is something which you get in many places, especially in shops, which has large garages, is basically you have some kind of a spherical mirror which is put on the top. And the spherical mirror actually can do a 360 degree imaging, and you can put a camera and record that. That kind of works, but there is a huge distortions in the system. And you realize that now the problem is, initially the problem was from a flat to a curved strip. Now your image is on a curved strip, you have to project it back to a flat sheet, and this is not very trivial. It gives you lots of aberrations in your problem. And second of all, what do you do with resolution? Your resolution is again seriously compromised. You won't get a high resolution. Well, it's not surprising. What people figured out was, why don't you use a camera array? You can use a lot of these cameras and very high-end cameras, and you can put them in an array and then go off and do it. Now, this is a technology which, if you as an experimentalist, if you are worrying about it, and I know that some of you are geeks with the open source hardwares, you'd say that, you know, that this can be made in labs. There are issues with it. First of all, how do you trigger all the cameras at the same time? How do you basically fix that the color quality of all the cameras are exactly the same? How do you basically join the cameras together so that you basically get one image which looks the right image? So there are problems with this. For example, if you have fixed it up and then one camera moves slightly, how do you find out that, you know, that the whole region of view is properly stitched and the stitches don't change when you're doing something on the fly? So these are issues which are serious issues and technical issues which you start to solve. But nevertheless, a simple laymanish approach of doing this problem would be this. And I thought that because we do so much of imaging, we'd say something about imaging, and then I will have Akash to tell you something about imaging.
I'm Akash in the BB30 lab. I'll be talking about how to build a high resolution camera
to extract data from experiments. We often need very high resolution cameras with a large field of view. But before going into the details of the camera, let's understand what an image is. An image is basically a rectangular array of dots called pixels. Now let's say I have this black and white image. And if I zoom in to this image, I can see that the image starts blurring. If I zoom in even more, I can see the pixels also. So one pixel contains 8 bits of information. That is, it can have 2^8, that is 256 possible combinations of zeros and ones. And that's how we can have a lot and lot of information in an image. Now, our goal is to make a high resolution camera with a large field of view. Now, I have drawn a schematic diagram of the camera here. In the right hand side, I have a sensor. In the middle, there is a lens. And in the left hand side, the object which I am trying to image. Now, as you can see, that my object is not discrete. So there are infinite number of points on my object, and those points are being projected on my sensor, which is discrete. And why is it discrete? Because there is a pixel width, which is roughly order of micrometer, and there are finite number of pixels in the sensor. And that is why this infinite number of points are being projected onto this finite number of pixels. That is how I am losing a lot of information from the object. So the less the field of view, more the information. And more the field of view, I have less information for a particular sensor. Now, what I do is I decrease the field of view, but I keep the sensor size same. So in this way,
So essentially the whole idea is that, you know, you play around with few things. One, you either make the sensor size same, but you have increased a larger field of view. If you do that, then basically you will lose on resolution, or else you make the sensor size very large and also have an associated large optics Well, you pay a huge bit of price for it. But if you wait, go to the somewhere in the middle, then you could come up with this design. You know, you distribute this over a large number of sensors. And what you have is this, you can have an array of these cameras and you can get this thing to working. This is almost the picture that I said to you earlier. Except that now what you can do is you can use your Raspberry Pis and you can use the cheap OEM cameras that your mobile phones have. And your mobile phones have pretty large resolution cameras on them. You can rig them up. You can connect them to this whole thing. Use wireless communications to basically transfer the data. You want to process the data, you can process it on the Raspberry Pis, the distributed computers that you have. And basically something which would otherwise cost you lakhs and lakhs of rupees, actually it will cost you roughly a crores of rupees, you can build it up in thousands of rupees, in 100, maybe 50,000 rupees, you can get an 8 to 10 camera sets in your system. It allows you also to do 360 degree views and things like that. So essentially, this is for a particular experiment that Akash was doing.
So in this way, we can have a very low cost, high resolution camera with a large field of view. Thank you.
So essentially, this is what the talk was all about, and I'll stop sharing the screen. So what we do? So we are basically these people who we observe new things, we figure out interesting questions, we are not afraid of building equipments, we don't worry about whether we can buy an equipment. Our experiments are never dictated by the equipments that you have in your lab. We essentially build any kind of an equipment that we require. And then sometimes, because we do all of this, we also occasionally discover something very interesting, cool, deep physics. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Shankar. It was really an amazing lecture. And I also want to thank Dharamveer, who gave this idea of trying to do something new under the heading Science Playground. Since there was no way that we could ever repeat California, so I just said, okay, I'll try talking to Shankar and have him on this platform to do an online Science Playground. I had not imagined what you would deliver, but I am really thrilled to watch what you have demonstrated. I grew up in BB30. There used to be an NMR spectrometer. I spent my first 15 years in TIFR in the same lab that you are here at the moment. And that lab is doing this many variety of things. And that is so vibrant. Congratulations to you. And thank you very much to you and your students for this amazing talk. While I was discussing things with Dharamveer, when he kept telling me, you know, he kept reminding me about Yashpal's turning point. So I told him, we cannot recreate Yashpal's turning point, but by having superposition of young people coming on this platform and inviting questions from people, we can create a virtual Yashpal's turning point, have different people, linear combination of different people or superposition of different people, answers, curiosities of the general public on what they see, what they observe, or what they want to understand. Let them post questions and we will have this a coalition of right people answer the curiosity of people of India. So one day I hope we will create also a virtual turning point with the help of talented people like you. So thank you very much once again. And I would like Kea to pose you the questions that he may have gathered from the chat box or from the Facebook. So over to Kea, please.
Yeah, I don't see any questions in the chat box in Zoom. And Anuj, if there are any questions from Facebook, otherwise I will ask those questions myself.
No, ma'am, there are no questions.
Shoot it.
So,
Anuj?
No, ma'am, there are no questions from Facebook too.
Ye kaise ho sakta hai, bhai?
There are lots of thank you comments, amazing lecture,
yeah,
this,
that's
that.
Right.
I think people are mesmerized with what he said.
Audience, this was the first lecture. Please ask your questions in the chat box. or you can ask us to unmute.
No, you can raise your hand and we will unmute you. We still have 75 people on Zoom with us. So, Meghna, Komal, Devdarshini, Dr. Sushil Kumar, Komal, Suman Bala. Okay. Then I ask my own question.
Yeah.
So, why do we study sand piles in such great detail? Do we have any applications of this?
Okay, so let me ask you, answer this. This is a slightly detailed question. See, everybody has his own take on sand pile. I'll take you what my take on sand pile is.
Okay.
So look at this particular problem that if you did normal physics, we did a Lagrangian, which told us that, you know, we can come up with a set of equations, which tells you that given an initial condition of a particle, you can always predict what the future is. Now, typically sand has friction associated with it. And this gives you the first problem. What friction does is, it tells you, bhai, main toh kisi ke chiz ko move kar diya, but it comes to a stop. Then for a different initial configuration, I started pushing something, that also comes to a stop. So now I have a problem that I have many configurations whose last configuration is stop. Basically, it's at zero velocity. Now, there is no way I can use now my equations of motion to backtrack it. Okay. So that gives rise to some kind of fundamental problems with physics as such. This is why systems with friction become interesting and how do you handle them? Second, you also have this problem that typically, you know, the way we do our physics, and especially, for example, van der Waals gas problem, you think of this problem that there has a finite size, you do a scattering cross section, but somehow when you're doing this calculation, you tend to forget about it. So what you do is, and if you have to take to consideration, you will say some very fast rising potential. But typically what happens is, so whenever you write an equation, you will write an equation on some manifold, say, for example, you know, say, for example, I want a harmonic oscillator. And the reason that I write a harmonic oscillator is because I'll say the harmonic oscillator lies on some line whose coordinates are given by x squared plus y squared is equal to the length square of the system. Now, that is a configuration. Nobody tells you what keeps the particle on that configuration manifold, but anyway, that's given to you. But with the friction, what happens, and with finite size particles, what happens is basically often what you do is you run into one particle to another particle so that the space associated with you is also curtailed. Okay, so the first one, the problem that I said was a dynamical constraint. This problem that I said is a kinematic constraint. Problem with how do you define spaces in physics? The third problem, which became very interesting, is this became an example of self-organized criticality. Now, I'll tell you what self-organized criticality. We all know there is a solid to liquid phase transition, and that happens at a particular temperature. At some point, people started looking at various systems, and they said, oh, you know, you can have fractals and things like that. And in about 1986, Kadnov is a very famous scientist who came up with this argument that, you know, you can find fractals almost in everywhere, so where is the physics in it? And then there was a very nice paper by Parbach, and then a lot of work in TIAFA was done, which is related to the self-organized criticality. And this probably in this pandemic regime is very interesting to know about it. So what it says is, your system is in a critical point. Look at a sand pile. Don't worry about what actual sand piles are, but actually, whatever is sand pile. Now, what happens is sand pile is an angle. Now, what do? You start pouring sand on it. So the angle slightly changes. And then what happens is suddenly there is an avalanche in the system and the sand pile is restored to that particular angle that you had. So somehow, without being very particular about some critical point, some temperature pressure, the system is choosing a critical point at which it wants to be. And you can't just take the system away from it. Because if you take the system away from it, the system will actually do some avalanches or some catastrophes and get back to the system. This is the reason why the sand pile problem and the sand problem is actually interesting.
Hello.
Thank you very much. That answers some of my questions, but it has raised many more questions. for example, how to deal a many body Lagrangian system. Okay, so we will deal with that later.
Non-holonomic constraints.
With non-holonomic constraints, yes. So what about, I can see so many BSc students.
They should be encouraged to ask questions.
Yeah, please. ये सबने अपने आप को इनविजिबल कर रखा है. हमें आपको देखना है भाई.
अनम्यूट करो अपने आप को.
अनम्यूट तो हम करेंगे, प्रोवाइडेड दे वांट टू आस्क अ क्वेश्चन.
अनम्यूट कर दो सबको.
अनुज जी.
मैम, देयर विल बी सो मच नॉइस देन इफ यू.
कोई बात नहीं,
अभी होने दो. को मेरे पार्लियामेंट में पीछे
पर नॉइस तो डील करना इनका काम है भाई.
अभी लॉ कर दो बात.
अब एंड हो गया, अब तो अनम्यूट करके पूछो सवाल सबसे. कोई
वी हैव अलाउड ऑल ऑफ द पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू अनम्यूट देमसेल्व्स. नाउ दे कैन अनम्यूट देमसेल्व्स.
लोन
Yes, ma'am. Today, from NRS College Rohtak, many students have joined.
Yes.
Yes, NRS Rohtak. I had been working the list, checklist. They have joined. Please ask some questions, bachcho. There are MSc students also. There was a name, Meghna.
आप जो है सवाल जनरल भी पूछ सकते हो. ये टाटा इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ फंडामेंटल रिसर्च में बहुत वरिष्ठ वैज्ञानिक हैं, तो ये वहाँ कैसे पहुंचे उनके बारे में भी पूछ सकते हैं. हाउ डिड ही बिकम सच अ डिस्टिंग्विश्ड फिजिसिस्ट. इट्स एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू टॉक टू सम ऑफ द ब्राइटेस्ट पीपल ऑफ आवर कंट्री.
डॉक्टर घोष का बचपन जहाँ बीता वो शायद रोहतक से छोटी जगह है.
बहुत छोटी.
कहाँ से हैं आप डॉक्टर साहब?
तो मैं तो सिलीगुड़ी से था, और तब का सिलीगुड़ी और आज का सिलीगुड़ी एक नहीं था.
आप देखिए, आप सिलीगुड़ी में कब पैदा हुए? बिकॉज आई माइट हैव विजिटेड सिलीगुड़ी बिफोर यू
वर बोर्न. यस,
आई विजिटेड सिलीगुड़ी थ्री टाइम्स, 63, 64 एंड 66. तो तीनों मेरे जन्म से तो पहले ही था. और इट मस्ट हैव बीन बिकम अ मच
बेटर टाउन बाय द टाइम यू वर बोर्न.
आपके जाने के बाद और आने, इतने बड़े साइंटिस्ट बनने के बाद कुछ आपने चेंज किया सिलीगुड़ी को? कुछ बच्चों को बुलाइए उधर से.
डॉक्टर सुदेश धर इज ट्राइंग टू से.
ओके,
शंकर.
या
योर फर्स्ट एग्जांपल वेयर यू टॉक्ड अबाउट चेंजिंग द शेप ऑफ अ फ्लैट प्लेन पेपर इनटू समथिंग एल्स, डू यू यूज एनी आइडियाज फ्रॉम टोपोलॉजी?
या सो दिस इज बेसिकली व्हाट वी आर डूइंग इज we are using the Ribbonian metric, so the topology remains constant. So for example, a flat will go to a flat, so you won't get a hole because then be a tear.
Exactly. But,
so you don't change the topology of the system. You change it's basically a it's any home. Yeah, it's a homomorphic transformation. So basically, a tear nahi karte system ko. So for example, this surface and a flat sheet is homomorphically the same. Continuous transformation se applicable. Yeah, all of this transformation are continuous. So this is the limitation that we do within the same class of systems. But ideas, jaise aapka
genus, mathematically they call it the genus remains the same.
Yeah, genus, so it's the same genus. अगर आपको center में hole चाहिए तो आप center में hole से शुरू कीजिएगा. मतलब पहले जो चीज है वो hole होगा. इस experiment में hole आप generate कर सकते हैं, but becomes more complicated. So otherwise we use this ideas of Riemannian metric. Metric कैसे define करते हैं surface के ऊपर, वो metric को modify कैसे किया जा सकता है, local regions को कैसे rotate किया जा सकता है. In fact, in some context, you know, maybe I'll just say, because nobody's asking me a question and you ask me, I'll tell you this. And it's a connection between your question and
क्या बोल रहे हैं बो?
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there is a connection between your question and the previous question. Is this that होता क्या है कि अगर आपके पास continuous medium है, अगर continuum theory किसी चीज का कर रहे हैं, जैसे एक solid का कर रहे हैं, कुछ भी कर रहे हैं, वहाँ के individual particle जो है वो rotate नहीं कर सकता है. क्योंकि आपका जो element है वो shear कर सकता है, पर घूम तो नहीं सकता है ना. पर ये particular system है, जब आप metric को change करते हैं, तो इंडिविजुअल एलिमेंट्स को आपको घूमने देना पड़ता है, तो मैकेनिक्स जो है वो बहुत अलग जैसे किस्म का मैकेनिक्स
होता है। बॉल बेयरिंग जो पुराना था वो हार्ड सरफेस था, हमने कहा इसके ऊपर कोटिंग लगा दो सॉफ्ट।
अच्छा,
चेंजिंग भी होती है। अच्छा, बहुत एडवांस हो गए।
Can I ask one more question if you don't mind?
Yeah.
You, while during a lecture, you mentioned that this technique is used for ball bearing. Do you think such a wider industrial application has taken place?
No, it has not taken place. I'll tell you where it comes from. I'll tell you where the whole idea is. The whole idea is, देखिए आप अगर friction पढ़ते हैं या कुछ भी कोई भी friction करता है, friction को usually एक number से define किया जाता है। कोएफिशिएंट ऑफ फ्रिक्शन हो, स्कूल लेवल में हम लोग पढ़ते हैं। पर अगर किसी सिस्टम को अगर आपको फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी देना है तो सिस्टम को आपको ये जो फ्रिक्शनल स्टेट है इसको टॉगल करवाना पड़ेगा, मतलब आपको चेंज करना पड़ेगा वैल्यू को। आप अगर वैल्यू चेंज कैसे करते हैं, द ओनली वे यू कैन डू इज टू से दैट ओके यू नो सम फाइनाइट अमाउंट ऑफ टाइम इट स्टेज इन वन हाई फ्रिक्शन स्टेट एंड इन सम अदर फाइनाइट अमाउंट ऑफ टाइम इट स्टेज इन अ लो फ्रिक्शन स्टेट। और अगर ये टॉगल करवा पाए तो आप इंटरेस्टिंग स्टेट्स लेके आ सकते हैं। देयर इज वन पर्टिकुलर एक्सपेरिमेंट व्हिच आई डिड नॉट टॉक अबाउट, सो आई एम इन दिस प्रोसेस ऑफ बिल्डिंग वेरी स्मॉल रोबोट्स एंड ऑफन वी यूज दिस पर्टिकुलर फीचर टू डू दैट, सो डू द टॉगलिंग एंड दैट्स द सिस्टम। द प्रिंसिपल इज लाइक अ बॉल बेयरिंग बट वी डोंट यूज इट फॉर द बॉल बेयरिंग प्रैक्टिकली, बट फॉर सम अदर कॉन्टेक्स्ट वी यूज दैट आइडिया।
थैंक यू। Grover sir,
so may we invite Professor Pasi to say something, because this lecture has been organized and the series has been commenced on behalf of NASI, and he being the president of the NASI Chandigarh chapter, it would be interesting to know what he feels about this after listening to the talk.
Pasi ji hai.
I think he is out of the lecture. I think Professor is not here.
So would Professor Dharvo want to say something at the end of the exercise? Professor Sudesh Dhar.
Thanks.
If not, then maybe request Professor, maybe request Dharamveer ji to conclude.
Well, thank you, please carry on. I butted in. Somebody was trying to speak.
Sir, R. Lohit of Jiva Public School. I have doubt, sir. What is mean by ball bearing?
ball bearing.
अच्छा.
Yes, sir.
तो वो होता क्या है कि आपका जो साइकिल का पहिया होता है ना, साइकिल जो होता है उसमें आप जैसे और वो घूमना आप असिस्ट करना चाहते हो कि आप चाहे कि साइकिल अच्छे से रन करे और उसको कहीं पे आप उसको होल्ड कर रहे हैं कहीं पे रॉड के ऊपर, तो ये रॉड और जो व्हील है उसका जो बीच में जो कनेक्शन होता है उसको बॉल बेयरिंग कहते हैं। तो एक ऐसा सर्कुलर चीज होता है उसमें बॉल साइकिल के गोलियां रहते हैं, तो ये बॉल बेयरिंग होता है।
सो कैन आई कंक्लूड प्रोफेसर शंकर घोष, थैंक यू वेरी मच ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द पार्टिसिपेंट्स, द SPSTI, नासी एंड माय ओन बिहाफ। इट वाज अ वेरी वंडरफुल लेक्चर, वेरी सिंपली एक्सप्लेन्ड, ए कॉम्प्लिकेटेड point has been explained so beautifully well, so I could also understand part of it even though I've left physics some more than 40 years ago, but I could pick up some of the threads. So we would also let you have a standing invitation from our side whenever you wish to talk to students, teachers of schools, colleges, universities. Please do let us know, we can always organize your talk. And we may come back to you after some time to speak to our people on some other topic. Professor Dhar, may also thank you for steering this session. एंड यू वर जैसे कहते हैं सूत्रधार थे आप इसके, और ग्रोवर साहब को भी मैं धन्यवाद करूंगा कि विद दिस सच फैंटास्टिक कॉन्टेक्स्ट वी आर एबल टू ऑर्गेनाइज सच डिस्टिंग्विश्ड लेक्चर्स. थैंक्स टू द पार्टिसिपेंट्स फॉर देयर प्रेजेंस एंड इंटरेक्शन. थैंक यू. जय हिंद. वुड समबडी लाइक Grover Saab, your last final word. आवाज नहीं आ रही. अनम्यूट किया वो.
अब की.
हेलो.
हाँ जी.
सो व्हेन वी आर प्लानिंग दिस सीरीज वी हैड होप दैट इट विल गो वेल बट ओनली व्हेन इट गोज वेल you can feel satisfied with it. You know, we can imagine, I'm an optimistic person, so we imagine all kinds of good things, but somebody has to make them look good. So Shankar has made them look good and sort of given us the confidence that we haven't commenced something very utopian. We have commenced something which is realistic, and I think we can develop this concept of online science playground. And hopefully, this successful conduct of it for a year or two will permit us to raise money and resource that we can have an actual science playground in the City Beautiful, which is full of large number of science and technologists. We have really a large number of scientists and technologists in a very small physical space in and around Chandigarh. So if a science playground has to be done, it ought to be attempted in Chandigarh. So I'm looking forward to it, though with our kind current pandemic and the kind of age that I am in, I don't know whether it will get done in next 5 to 10 years, but I think somebody else will pick up the threads from where we would leave. So I'm very, very happy that we did whatever we did.
Grover Saab, I have already started looking for some land near Chandigarh in Haryana, around Narayangarh area. And once we are able all to... So I would request every one of you to contribute even a small 1 rupee. Jaise ek, one of our former leaders in Haryana said, 1 rupiah, 1 vote. So I would say that even if you contribute 1 rupee, we'll consider it a great donation and commitment for setting up a playground in physical form and making science and technology available to the common man. I'm very sure that we'll be able to do it next 4 to 5 years' time. With this, I thank everyone, especially Professor Grover, Professor Shankar Ghosh, and my team from the SPSTI, Anuj Goyal, Mahipal Sharma, and Rajni Bhalla. Once again, I thank you very much and Jai Hind.
Participants may note down our upcoming lectures, which are now displayed on the screen.
मेरा नान का भी घोष
सारे
मेरी मदर घोष
है बाबा जी इनके मामा जी से मेरी बात बनती थी.
अच्छा
बनती थी. एक बार के तो मुझे डर हो गई थी. दोनों भी डर.
दिस इज आवर ईमेल आईडी एंड वेबसाइट एड्रेस. सो नो नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू एंड द सेशन इफ प्रोफेसर किया धर्मवीर मैम अलाउस.
यस वी विल नाउ. सो थैंकिंग एवरीबॉडी एंड इट हैज बीन अ वंडरफुल सेशन. आई एंजॉयड माय सेल्फ थॉरली. थैंक यू वेरी मच.
थैंक यू मैम.
Thank you.
कितना लिखते हैं।